Welcome again. And last time we were talking about the one-dimensional system U equal approximately equal to 40 and things like labeling of the states as covalent and ionic, ARBs, and different spin states. And now what I am going to be talking about is what happens to these things in the case of polyenes. So in polyenes, what we mean by polyenes is polyacetylenes. So here you have the ground state, and I can say that we have the conduction band edge here. So that electron and hole are not bound in this region and they can move around independently. So now given this, what we have is we have various kinds of states. So which I can call on the right side, I will write triplets, although I can also write higher spin states, I will not go into that one, and on the left side I will write singlets. And in singlets, usually you will have the ground state is a singlet AG, one singlet AG, and the excited state in the covalent space is a bunch of states formed by second singlet AG, and so on until about n singlet AG, and all these are covalent. Okay, so this is a covalent space. You can have both A and B, of course. I have just written A type of states, but you can also have the B type of states. Then on the ionic side, you have maybe one singlet BU ionic, and then so on and so forth, and then n singlet BU or AU, it does not matter, it is all ionic. One singlet B, I do not have to give the index of the inversion center because it is just duplicating the whole thing. So even here I do not have to write G. Because when you say A, it is clear that it is, that is what it is. So in triplets, you have a triplet covalent which is B covalent triplet, that will be the first one. And then you will be having various kinds of triplets which are ionic triplets, triplet A or B, whatever, okay, and ionic. And covalent also you will have A or B, higher, okay, N triplet ARB covalent, here also N triplet ARB ionic. So I have the covalent triplet is always lower in the energy than the ionic triplets, and ionic triplets are usually higher in the energy than the lowest ionic singlet. And what we have is, so it is a very rich spectrum. We have a large number of states below the excitation the electron hole continuum or below the band gap. And there are lots of interesting things about this one. So the first interesting thing is that this energy gap, that is if I have a second singlet A covalent is lower in energy than one singlet B ionic, then by Kasha rule, the polymer will be non-luminescent. One way of looking at it is that, you know, if you want to have a absorption, then the charges, electromagnetic radiation, if it has to be absorbed, then the charges have to move, and charges are easily moved in the ionic space than in the covalent space. So the covalent space does not have transition dipole, whereas the transition dipole is from singlet AG to singlet B covalent. Okay, this is always covalent. So singlet AG covalent, first singlet AG covalent to first singlet B ionic. So this is one thing that you can say. And the second thing you can say is that, you know, when correlations increase, so let me or use a highlighter. So when the correlations increase, so all these states in large U limit will go to spin waves, spin wave excitations, because these are covalent states, okay, and you will have spin wave excitations from that, okay. And so that's another important thing. And one more thing is that the knowing this is very important, because first of all, you will be able to say when a system is luminescent or not. And the second thing is that, you know, people talk about these days something called singlet fission. This is opposite of triplet-triplet annihilation. So if you are wondering how from a singlet you can get triplets, let me just put it this way. Let me look at triplet-triplet annihilation. So for the triplet, so this I call TTA process, and this I call SF, singlet fission. In the TTA process, you have two triplets, okay. So you can get from two triplets the total, S total can be 2, 1 or 0, because it is S1 plus S2 to modulus S1 minus S2, since S1 is equal to S2, you have 2, 1 and 0 are the allowed states. So triplet-triplet annihilation can give you a singlet. Similarly, if two molecules are in a singlet state, the total singlet, the two molecules are independently in singlet states, they can interact with each other, they can yield two triplets. Why is yielding triplets so important? The reason why yielding triplets is so important is the following. That is, look at this one. So supposing a one of these states can give two of these, that is one singlet can give rise to two triplets, okay. Then what happens is, supposing light is absorbed, you know, you are trying to devise a photovoltaic system or a photo this thing, organic solar cell, which is very highly efficient, then when a photon is absorbed, it goes from singlet AG to singlet B, and when it goes to singlet B, then if the energy of singlet B is fairly high compared to the triplets, then singlet B can give you two triplets. And if the triplet is at least about 1 electron volt above the singlet state and ground state, then it can actually, you know, after dissociation can carry current with sufficient voltage that it is going to give you enough power. So you can have two triplets being formed, and so you will have twice the number of carriers. If you have twice the number of carriers, you have twice the efficiency of the system. So this is one way of actually breaking the Shockley-Kaiser barrier using these kinds of techniques, and people have tried to design systems based on these things. So for this, one of the energetic criterions is that E, the lowest gap, okay, lowest singlet, that should be greater than twice lowest triplet. And then you must also have E lowest singlet should be greater than E second lowest triplet, because if it was not the case, then it is possible that the singlet will go into a second lowest triplet instead of actually breaking up into two triplets. So these are the energetic criterions, and people have designed systems based on anthracenes, or rather tetracene and pentacenes, which closely satisfy these kinds of criteria, and one can get good efficiencies. Well, this is about basically what I wanted to say about the energy level ordering of these systems. But now I will go over to a slightly different thing. That is, I will look at systems away from half filling. For example, at half filling and large U, what happens is you have uniform charge density along the chain. Every one of the sites will be singly occupied, but we will have spin orientations will be following. We will have spin orientations which go as up, down, up, down, up, down. So, when you have uniform charge density, it means lambda tends to infinity, okay, the wavelength. Whereas here lambda is equal to 2a, where a is the site distance. So, given this, how do you rationalize this? This is we have kf is equal to pi by 2a because it is half filled. So, 2kf is equal to pi by a, and lambda corresponding to this is 2 pi divided by 2kf is equal to 2 pi divided by 2 pi into 2a. Okay, so that will turn out to be 2a. This is not so interesting as what will happen when we go to when we are at quarter filling. Okay, let us consider only U and nearest neighbor V. Okay, it is called the UV model. So, when you have quarter filling and U is small, okay, then what happens is the system will be in a state like 2, that is doubly occupied site, empty site, empty site, doubly occupied site, empty site, empty site, doubly occupied site, empty site, empty site. So, this is actually this distance is 4a because this distance is a, the lattice constant is a. So, in this case you have kf is equal to pi by 4a, right. So, when you have 2kf is equal to 2 pi by 4a and lambda corresponding to 2kf is equal to 4a. So, you have a system with which has a CdW which is 2kf and there is no SdW. So, there is no spin density wave. Oh, by the way, here I should say something else because you have uniform charge density, but then you will have what is called a bond order wave, BOW. Which means you have a Pyle's distortion in the system giving rise to alternately double and single bonds. So, that is called a bond order wave. It is just a fancy word. Now, let us go to large U limit. In the large U limit, the system will prefer to have a configuration like this. So, what is happening in this limit is simply the charge is going to be on alternate sites, one electron, but the spin is going to be having 4a, that is lambda is equal to 4a for the SdW and lambda is equal to 2a for a CdW. Okay? So, when you are looking at this, then you will find that kf again is in this case pi by 4a, and what we have is that the SdW is actually a 2kF SDW. Okay, because it is repeating every 4 sites, and we saw just now that 2kF means repeating 4 sites. But when you look at the charge density wave, this is going to be a 4kF charge density wave, because the wavelength is going to be shorter. The distance between charges is only 2 lattice sites. So, it is the kF is twice, or the wave the kF will be twice, so that the wavelength will be shorter. Okay, so this is one of the few things. So you can have coexistence of 2kF CDW and 4kF, rather 2kF SDW and 4kF CDW in systems which are quarter filled. And quarter filled systems are also very interesting, because what you have is, let me only consider the charge. If I consider the charge, the ground state can be written as 1 0 1 0 1 0 1 0 1 0 1 0. Now, supposing I dope an electron, that is what I do is I will put an electron into this one, okay, so that the system becomes 1 0 1 0 1 1 1 0 1 0 1 0. Okay. Now, because the electrons tend to hop, this can keep hopping this way and this can keep hopping this way. So, if that happens, then slowly what you will end up with is the following, 1 0 1 1 0 1 1 0 1 0 1 0. That means, and this can continue further, just to illustrate, then what I can have is 1 0 1 1, and then I have a 0 here. This electron goes in there, so this is here. And so, this site will be 0, that is correct, and the next 2 sites will be 1. And I can still have the following, that is 1 0 1 1 0, then it will be again, this will be again 1, and this can hop and become 0, and 1 0 1 0. So, what's happened is, by the hopping of the electrons, you have created 2 kinks. These are kinks which demarcate 1 0 1 0 and 0 1 0 1 charge ordering. Just as in the case of polyacetylenes, we had double bonds and single bonds alternating starting from the ends, and then when you had odd number of carbon atoms, then in the middle you had a crossover, and the crossover was in this case is the crossover is 1 1 and 1 1. So, when you dope one electron, we have doped one electron, but we obtained 2 solitons. So, the charge on each soliton is 1/2. And this is called fractionally charged solitons. Well, I think I have said whatever is interesting about, in my opinion at least, about PPP model and extended range Hubbard models and their excitations. Now, let me go over to the study of lattice vibrations, because that is something that I had said in the beginning, that we will discuss lattice vibrations. So, we will discuss lattice vibrations in the next 1.5 or 2 hours. So, now we will look at lattice vibrations. When you have n atoms, okay, then there are 3n degrees of freedom. supposing these n atoms are moving around independently, if each atom moves independently, then all of them are translational moves. All of them are translation degrees of freedom along x, y, and z. Then all degrees of freedom are translational. Now, what happens when you actually bring it into a solid? So, the question is, what happens if you crystallize them? Put it on an ordered lattice. Okay, for convenience, what we will do is we will consider only one dimensional lattice. So, when we consider only one dimensional lattice, let me write down the one dimensional lattice in terms of a box. It is much easier that way. So, this is a one dimensional lattice. I have the unit cell. Okay, so now these atoms are at, let us say, equilibrium positions to begin with. Okay, all these atoms, now if all the atoms move to the right by the same amount, okay, so if all the atoms move to the right by the same amount, you have a translation. Okay, so actually if you translate a crystal, now you have changed nothing because you have the Galilean invariance, and so because of that the energy involved in this is zero. That is, the crystal system does not change its energy. You know, you have to put in energy to move the object, but internally the crystal system, there is no change in energy. Now, you can also think of another kind of motion. Okay, let me write down the lattice again. So, I can think of one atom moving to the right and another atom moving to the left. And here it moves to the right, here it moves to the left, and here it moves to the right, this one moves to the left. Moves to the right, moves to the left, moves to the right, moves to the left, moves to the right, moves to the left. So, with equal amplitude. So, supposing I say that the displacement of an atom in the lth unit cell is UL, if we say the displacement of the atom in lth unit cell is UL, then UL is equal to minus 1 to the power L U, okay, some constant. Okay. So, this is what happens, and you see that the energy for this process is much higher because what you are doing is you are compressing a bond, elongating a bond. So here you are compressing a bond, here you are elongating a bond, compressing again, elongating again, compressing, elongating, compressing, elongating, compressing, elongating, and so forth. So because you are working against the this chemical bond in some sense, you are going to be having a higher energy for this process, and the energy for this motion is high. In fact, it will be the highest of all kinds of motions that you can think of, which will come to later on. So now what you have is that, what is the wavelength? Wavelength of the displacement is 2a. Okay, so you can actually see that. So supposing I say that I will plot displacement along this axis against site index. So what you have is a positive displacement here, negative here, positive here, negative here, positive here, negative here, positive here, negative here, so on, so that you can actually pass a wave which has a wavelength of so the wavelength lambda is equal to 2a, and if lambda is equal to 2a, then what is k? K is equal to pi by a. Very much like the hydrogen case. Hydrogen atom chain, where the most bonding and least bonding corresponded to k is equal to 0 and k equal to pi by a. Now what happens in between? So let us see what happens in between. So to see that, you can have a in between situation where the atoms are not exactly moving against each other, but are moving in a different way. So let me put it, show it how it they can move. So supposing this atom moves a lot to the right, this one moves a little less, this one does not move, this one moves to the left a little bit, this one moves to the left a lot more, and this one moves to the left a little less, this one does not move, this one moves to the right a little bit, right a lot more, and right a little less, and right 0. So if for this, if I were to look at the displacements will look like this. The site 1 will be displacement will be large, the second site displacement will be small, and the other one will be 0. And then you have a small downward displacement, large downward displacement, again a small downward displacement, and then 0 displacement, and then upward displacement, positive displacement to the right is always positive, to the left is negative. That is the way I have taken the displacements. So and then I have this and I have 0. So this looks like a wave. Okay, and this has wavelength, you know, in this case the wavelength is how much? So from here to there, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay, so lambda is equal to 8a, and I will have k is equal to 2 pi by 8a, or equal to pi by 4a. So like this, I will have various kinds of movements. There are all kinds of movements of the atoms, movements of atoms at sides. So they are always moving in some cohesion, in some this thing, coherent fashion, like a wave. Now the point is that, you know, how many allowed values of k are there? This is the question that we had also asked in the energy band theory. How many allowed k values are there? So, for example, uk, I can write it in the form sigma over l equal to 1 to n e to the power I k l a times ul, where ul is the displacement at the site. And here we know that, supposing all these n atoms are in a ring, okay. So, for example, you assume that all these n atoms are in a ring. Going from 1, 2, etc. to n. Then if I change n to n plus 2, let us say, then I should get back the same displacements. At site 2 as before, because it is a ring and then it does not matter, you know, whether you go around the ring once or only twice or whatever. So, which means that e to the power I k l plus n a is equal to e to the power I k l a. Okay. So, this is a condition that we also had for the band structure, because we use the single valuedness of the wave function. So, it means that k n a must be equal to 2 pi into some integer r. R can take values 0, plus minus 1, plus minus 2, etc., etc. Okay. So, what we have is that we will get k is equal to 0 plus minus 2 pi by n a plus minus 4 pi by n a, and so on and so forth. So, how many k values should be there? There are n longitudinal modes. Because you have n atoms, you have n longitudinal modes and 2n transverse modes, which are the two transverse modes are independent. So, which means that k should be confined to one Bilirubin zone. To first Bilirubin zone, that is to say minus pi by a less than k less than or equal to pi by a, and this corresponds to n degrees of freedom. Now, let us see how the this thing will vary. So, we expect our dispersion to vary the following way. Omega versus k should be lowest around here, somewhere in between and somewhere high. Okay. But we do not know how it will go. The nature of the curve is not known. So, we know a few points, but the nature of the curve is not known. So, to know the nature of the curve, what we will do is, we will make an harmonic approximation. We will make a harmonic approximation to get the nature of the curve, to get the dispersion. So, which means harmonic approximation means that each bond behaves like an harmonic spring, behaves like a harmonic spring. And we apply Hooke's law and obtain the frequencies. That we will do in the next lecture. I will stop here for this lecture and we will continue again. Thank you.